micro explosions. Emotions, we don't need to talk about emotions, right? I've already talked about emotions. You need slurries, okay? You guys want to talk about slurries? We have all sorts of things. Slurries. Slurries is, again, slurries basically you mix powders in liquid. You need to have some chemical to make them stay as a slurry, right? So the solid particles do not separate down. But anyway, that's what it is. And I've talked about coil mixtures for pumpabilities and the metal particle suspensions, okay? And this. Now, the major problem, a lot of people don't realize, and then when they do it, then just things just don't burn well. And they don't understand because they're not a combustion guy. So we combustion guys are smarter, right? So no, I'm serious that they are. I'll tell you some other things. So see, the problem is you have a slurry. You have a slurry droplet, whatever. So the liquid vaporizes. The particle do not vaporize. Why would the particle vaporize? Particle doesn't have vapor pressure, okay? So the liquid will vaporize and the particle there, and the particle would gradually become more concentrated. And they don't diffuse. Particles don't diffuse. So then the surface, they just get more and more concentrated, right? The surface regresses, they get more. And eventually they get so concentrated, they're stuck with each other, okay? Right? Very quickly. So then they form a shell. And their size don't decrease anymore. So then what happens, the liquid inside would then go through this porous medium, porous shell, and then they'll vaporize from the surface. Okay? They'll go through the porous thing. So eventually the liquid will all vaporize through this shell, porous shell, and then you end up with a porous shell. Okay? And this porous shell would then somehow burn. But then it'll take a long time. Okay? So the thinking, people originally thinking of slurry, it's a long time ago, in the 80s or something, they say, oh, there's oil crisis those times. So they say, okay, let me put carbon particle in diesel engine. Right? Let me make the carbon particle really small, 1 micron. Then they calculate. 1 micron particle, how long it takes. It can burn 1 micron particle, okay? During the period, right? What's the problem with that? You are not burning micron particles. You are burning a whole shell. Those whole shell got hundreds, thousands of particles there. It's a big agglomerate. It takes that. That's why it never burns. It burns terrible. And that is the problem. That is the problem. And now let me show you this thing. So it's very simple. So here's the cartoon. You have this one. So initially it'll vaporize, but very quickly you form a shell. And the liquid inside will go through the shell to vaporize. Okay? And then eventually, of course, the shell might explode. When it's all gone, shell will go. Otherwise, it remains shell. And then that's what you see. See that? You let them burn a whole spray, and then in the end, you collect it, you get all these shells at the bottom. And you say, wow, things. See that? Yeah, I mean, it's real. It's from real combustors. And what's interesting, you guys, you have to see it. You study flow mechanics. All the shell is open on one end. See that? All the shell open on one end. Why does it open on one end? Opens on one end because the droplet's moving, right? In the environment. So there's motion over the droplet, right? And there's the wake behind the droplet. You guys all study flow mechanics. There's separation behind the droplet, okay? So the separation there, the formation is not that easy. So this hose represents the separation point. So you get all those holes. That's where your flow mechanics come into question. Mm-hmm. So, but that's the problem. In powder making, you get all these holes, they clump together, you get big powders. You don't want that. People want to make powders. Okay? So that's what it is. So something interesting too, because this vapor, when it goes through the shell gets thicker and thicker because the particles would collect on the shell. And then actually the thickening of the shell goes like sort of what's called D cube law. It's like a cube of the size. All right. Okay, so that's slurries. All right. So we see what we have. Alcohols. We got all sorts of fun stuff. Okay. You burn alcohols. So what's the problem? I think I've told you already. Alcohols, they dissolve water. Okay? So you have alcohol. Just think. You have alcohol droplet. It started burning, surrounded by a flame. What does the flame generate? What's the product of combustion?
Water.
So what happened to this water? The water will back diffuse and then go to the droplet, it'll dissolve into the droplet. Okay? So therefore, your methanol burning, for example, a single droplet burning, you can do it. This experimental data, real data, okay? Tiny droplets, 100 micron, thinner than your hair, for example, it burns, and then you collect the sample, and then you measure this water content. So as it goes, the water mass fraction, initially nothing, it's pure methanol, then it can even go to, what is it, about 80%. It'll be so concentrated with water. But the interesting thing is it still burns. 80% water with methanol, this meth still burn, okay? Then it extinguishes. And then, of course, ethanol also dissolves water, okay? So that's why you cannot have too much, ethanol with gasoline mixture, 15% either on one side or 85% on the other side. Otherwise, it would dissolve water, make it less burn, all right? The thing is, then you go to propanol. This is C, right? This is one carbon, two carbons, ethanol. Propanol, three carbons. Propanol doesn't dissolve water. Why? Propanol boiling point is the same as water boiling point. Okay? So they just don't have volatility differentials. Practically doesn't dissolve water. There are three very interesting liquids you guys want to know. It's good for your experiment to these things, okay? There are three magic liquids. They have the same boiling point. It's convenient. Water, propanol, heptane. All 100 degrees boiling point. Okay? So certain times you want to match the boiling point and things. So those are three very nice candidates to study. Okay. So those is what happens with ethanol. Alcohols. Now, this is something, what's called, what I just told you about. It's a reactive liquid propellants. It's what's called organic azides. We talk about the burning rate constant. The K, right? The D square law, the burning rate constant, how fast they burn. So there's this group of liquids, okay? It's called organic azides. R is any kind of organic functional group, okay? And then if you take an N3 here and take an N3 here, you take an N3, it's called azide. I don't know whether you guys know. Who knows about azides? Have you ever heard of azides? No. Extremely explosive stuff, okay? If it's sodium azide, or those kind of things, don't play with it. It explodes like it's crazy. All right. So, nitrogen compounds. On the one hand, you say it's inert, but nitrogen is extremely. That's what TNT, right? All those, it's nitrogen compounds. So, what this group of fuels are is that if you measure the burning rate constant K, that K. For the regular hydrocarbon, the D square law, the slope is about typically 1 millimeter per second, something like that. But this kind of guys, they go, this is the number of carbon atoms in alkane. So this is a C4 dioxide, C5 dioxide, C6 dioxide. C6, that's diazidohexane, diazidooctane, diazidodecane. See, that burning rate can go 7 times the regular fuels, okay? That burning rate can go 7 times. Now, this is not trivial. For hydrocarbon burning, I just told you, the burning rate goes log 1 plus B, correct? The burning rate constant, I just showed you, right? K equals log 1 plus B. Log 1 plus B, so this B is your driving force. You want something to increase by a factor of 7, log 1 plus B. So B has to increase by E to the 7, correct? Log 1 plus B equals burning rate. So your burning rate increases by 7, the B has to go E to the 7. There's no way, based on what we thought of, this can go with E to the 7. Your heat transfer number, the B. No way. I don't know whether you guys appreciate what I said. Let me. I have to go back to this. I want to show you the burning rate constant. Okay? Just give me a minute. It's an important concept. Okay. See, we derived this heat transfer number. This guy, and then this heat release in the gas phase. This is the latent heat of vaporization, okay? So, right, for this guy to go factor of 7, B has to go to E to the, this E, right? B go to E to the 7. That's a huge, huge number. For B to go to the E to the 7, if you look at this formula, how can you get E to the 7? I mean, your heat of combustion just, it cannot increase by E to the 7th effect. It's huge. Mm-hmm. So what is happening is this guy, this liquid, they would react, they would decompose in the liquid. They would decompose in the liquid phase, okay? Those azides. And when they decompose in the liquid phase, they will release heat. And that heat is used to reduce this heat. Latent heat of vaporization. This is not a big number, latent heat of vaporization. This is a big number, heat of combustion is a big number. Latent heat is not a big number. So if you just have some heat release in the liquid, and that heat can be used for gasification to compensate for the latent heat of vaporization. Okay? So in the limit, you can think of, if you have a heat release in the gas phase, which is the same as latent heat of vaporization, or even bigger than latent heat of vaporization, the the lesson here is that for droplet burning or liquid phase burning, whatever, okay, the controlling diffusion of burning is the diffusion rate from the gas phase to the liquid. And the diffusion rate is limited by the diffusivity. That's why you get all these locks and something. It just cannot, you know, you just cannot get the heat to there real, real fast. It's still diffuse. Cannot be. So one trick is that you do things in the liquid phase. Okay? You play around with the liquid phase rather than the gas phase. Gas phase, there's just so much you can push. Everything is locked. You want to put more heat to it, you want to go in here, it vaporizes faster, it pushes the heat away. See that? This lock function. So what you do is do it in the liquid phase or in the condensed phase. That's where the things can go. That's a lesson you guys want to sort of remember. So that's what okay, I got a lot of things. So this guy, okay? So this guy not only, because it's got heat generation in the liquid, so it reduces the latent heat of vaporization, it can vaporize fast, it generates so much heat, the whole thing explodes. Okay? Very fast. All right? But be very careful working with this, some of this. I mean, we had our shares of essence. So, all right, let's see. Okay, let's talk about co-particle. Okay? So I skip a lot on droplets. So I want to cover other things. Co-particle burning. Basically, it goes into carbon particle. So you have a co-particle burning. Typically, what's happening is that co-particles in the furnace and all that. The first 10%, very rough, 10% of the lifetime is the co-particle, its biomass, right? It'll decompose, okay? It'll decompose, it gets heated up, decompose. It'll release some volatiles, go up, right? So about first 10%, it'll generate a volatile fuel vapor. And so there could be some gas phase flames. And the particle temperature at this point, say less than 1,000 degrees. Right? It's just pyrolyte, not much. And then eventually the porous, the volatile component will go out. Then you end up with a porous residual particle, which then can consist of any amount of carbon. Basically, and you end up with carbon and with a lot of other junk, okay? Metallic oxides, whatever. Minerals, things like that. So how good a coal is depends on how much carbon it originally composed, right? Some place, Australia, some, they got wonderful coal, right? Because it's mainly carbon. Some place got real low-grade coal because they got a lot of junk, less than carbon, okay? Depends on coal type. So therefore, what it says is that during most of the burning period, is really gasification of carbon, all right, in burning coal. So that's why you really have to know carbon burning for coal burning, all right? There are other considerations, but to the leading order it is. So how does carbon burn? If you think deeper, right, it's a porous structure. So they will be burned in the surface, but they will also diffuse through the pores and then burn. And diffusing through the pores, it's a whole science. Depends on the pores. Some of the pores can be very, very small, right? Okay? Less than mean free path of the gas, how it goes. And sometimes the pores are blind pores. What's called blind pores is this, you don't have, normally you don't have pore, but it regresses to that place, suddenly something opens up. Then you can go into it. So now, but the interesting thing is that what I want to discuss with you is that the burning, let's just talk about the burning of carbon, it'll involve both surface and gas phase reactions. Okay? Hydrocarbon burning, I just mentioned it, it's gas phase burning. Carbon burning, remember, involves a lot of surface burning. Okay? So let's talk about this. All right, so what are the major surface reaction. Let me just give you the basic chemistry. This is not elementary reaction now, global reactions. You have, obviously, carbon would react with oxygen, give you CO2, okay? But what is interested in, especially, I don't know how many of you appreciate this, carbon would react with CO2 and give you 2CO, okay? Carbon would react with 2CO. And that's a major, major route of oxidation of carbon at the surface. All right. Now, so for example, this, now also, I'm sorry, C1 here, C2, of course. Okay, C plus O2 goes CO2. There's another row, 2C plus O go into 2CO, okay? And carbon with CO2 go into 2CO, forming carbon monoxide. And carbon will react with water, gives you CO plus H2. Okay, those are the major reactions, global reactions. So this, first of all, C1 is negative compared to C2 for this guy. So when the temperature gets high, it's really this guy dominate, okay? C plus O2 going to CO. And the low temperature route is, basically go into this one. And the high temperature route, and then go to C3, okay? C plus CO2 going to 2CO, into saturation. Now, recognize that the product of C2 and C3 is CO. Okay? And this guy also produces CO. And the gas phase reaction basically is CO plus O2. It's not carbon plus O2. Okay? It's CO plus O2. There's another thing. I wonder whether I want to say this first. Let me go back to here. So the product, again, remember now, the product of the gas phase reaction, I'm giving you several bits, and then very soon I'm going to put them all together. Product of the gas phase reaction, C5, this is the gas phase reaction, okay? I have CO going to O2 going to CO2. What happens when I get the CO2? The CO2 will come back and react with carbon. I have the gas phase reaction, CO reacting with O2, give me CO2. CO2 comes back, react with C, and give me CO. Okay? So surface reaction is very much essential in generating the reactant for the gas. Now, the second point is really very sobering. Okay? Conventional fire extinguishing agents, CO2 and water. How you put out a fire, right? You use water, do it. Use CO2, do it. Carbon dioxide. What happens? You put water to it. You spray it in carbon, which is on fire. It's very happy. It says, give me more. Because you do this, it gives you CO plus H2. They are both combustibles. You spray in there, it generates combustible, comes out, sustain your fire. Mm-hmm. You spray with CO2, it says, give me some more. It gives you CO. It'll do that. Okay? This is a real, real problem. When you have carbon fire, you cannot extinguish it. Uh-huh. What's the problem? What's the big problem? Nuclear reactor. Nuclear reactor got graphite fires. They use graphite to moderate the neutron. When you have a nuclear reactor fire, no way to put it out. What do they do? You know what they do? They bury it. That's all. Okay? That's a serious problem. That's what carbon does to you. Mm-hmm. Okay? So, but those are all real. I'm not making carbon fire. You cannot put up. Mm-hmm. Right? Okay? So this one. They will produce CO and H2. So now, carbon got very special properties. Mm-hmm. Carbon does not melt. I haven't really seen people try to, but just doesn't seem carbon doesn't melt. Hydrocarbon, of course, it's liquid. Carbon doesn't melt. Sublimation temperature is greater than 4,000 degrees K. Carbon. Okay, they sublime. They don't melt, 4,000. Hydrocarbon, basically the boiling point is 7,400, 800. So carbon is therefore very non-volatile, extremely non-volatile, okay? So therefore carbon can be heated to very high temperatures. What I mean is the following. You have, remember the hydrocarbon fuse. You heat it up, and then eventually it get to the boiling point, and that's it. It doesn't go any higher because it's vaporizing very fast. Take away the heat, okay, right? Carbon doesn't gasify. I mean, it doesn't melt, and it's got much higher temperature, sublimation temperature. So carbon particle temperature, it can easily exceed the burner temperature. Okay, when carbon particle burns, its temperature can be higher than the burner temperature. Mm-hmm. And guess what? If you have a carbon fire in aircraft, you have carbon fire, you have things burning, not carbon fire. Anything that burns produces soot. What is soot? Carbon. Okay? Right? So this soot can be heated to very high temperatures, really high temperatures. And what happens when you inhale it? It rips your whole inside, burns your whole inside. Okay? That's what carbon is. Just so carbon. Okay, remember carbon. So now, of course, it never actually goes to 4,000 degrees. This is sublimation temperature. Usually the radiation loss, when it gets about 250, 3,000, radiation loss is so strong, it limits the temperature. Okay? But still very high. So then what it means? So the particle temperature is not very high. I mean, it's much less than sublimation temperature. So therefore it's low. Basically, the gasification rate is small compared to hydrocarbons. Hydrocarbons, they gasify very fast. This one doesn't gasify very fast. There's no sublimation or vaporization. So that's what it means. Low volatility and surface temperature, increased surface reaction is important. I've told you guys, right? Surface reaction is, we have this surface reaction, and we have this surface reaction. These are all surface reactions. Surface reactions is really what matters. Right? So you guys, those are, you know, always just, that's why this lecture is on heterogeneous burning and diffusional burning and all this. You have to appreciate that there's other reactions more than gas phase, right? There's surface reactions. So there's possible couplings, present coupling, both surface and gas phase reactions. So let me just show you typically what you have. if you don't have any gas phase, if you just throw a carbon particle in a hot, high temperature environment, then what you have is that you have to have you say, for example, you have oxygen in the environment, which will go to the surface, right? And oxygen in the environment, and oxygen here react with carbon, gives you CO. CO will go out. You know, oxygen will come here. They react. So the surface reaction is 2C plus O2 to CO2. Now, if you have a flame here, if it started burning with a flame here, then suddenly it changes because of what? Because you have, let's just say, you have the CO, you have the, let me see, the surface, let's just say start with something, okay? Surface of CO come out. And CO will react with the oxygen, give me CO2. And CO2 will come back here, give me CO, and CO comes back. So whereas in this case, it's the oxygen that goes to the surface and reacts. Whereas in this case, the oxygen is stopped here and the CO2 that comes to the surface to react. Okay? Right? Is that clear? Because this flame consumes my CO and gives me CO2. And it's the CO2 that oxidizes, the C. Whereas in here, it's the O2 that oxidizes. So when you have a carbon particle burning, initially it's just burning without a flame, and it burns at a certain rate. And if you suddenly have a flame established, the burning rate changes, fundamentally changes, because the oxidation agent changes. All right? The controlling reaction changes, goes into this. So it's, you know, carbon burning is a really very interesting problem. You have to. Because of the surface reaction and the coupling with the gas phase and the radiation. And then really you think deeper, actually it's a porous medium, okay? For coal, so it's porous medium. So it's far from being understood. Mm-hmm. Okay, let's see. Metal particle, okay, we've got all sorts of fun things. Metal, now if you think deeper, hydrocarbon burning, Okay, we are combustion guys, right? We study hydrocarbon burning. How many elements you have there? C, H, O. Three. Sometimes putting nitrogen, huh? You are interested in nitrogen, oxides of nitrogen. Say three. You look at the periodic table. How many elements? At least 92, right? Okay? You just think deeper. You combine the one on the left-hand side with the one on the right-hand side. You can get all the fun stuff. Okay? And their combination also can be a lot more complex. Because for hydrogen and O, you just have H2O and OH and HO2. No, H2O2, HO2. But the other, when you have all metals and other things, you have different phases. You guys, if any one of you have studied materials, different phases, you're tremendous. Okay? So, yesterday in a panel discussion, right? You guys say your career. So if you think outside, the whole table of elements is under our control. Your potential is incredible. The potential of doing things is incredible. These materials, metals burning. Okay? So somewhat encouraging. So, but in terms of practical interest, for example, accidental fires and explosions in mine galleries. So I'll just tell you stories. We don't have to be done this. When do I have to quit? 5:30? Huh? When's my time of quitting? 5:30? Huh? 5:30? Okay. Accidental fires and explosions in mine galleries. You know how mine fire starts. Mine fire starts is that you drill the coal mine, for example, typically coal mine, right? And then suddenly that you hit a pocket because it was a coal dam, basically. It's an empty, it's a pocket. You drill suddenly, you hit a pocket. Inside the pocket, there's a lot of methane gas trapped there, all right? And this methane gas come out suddenly, and then when you're drilling it, you get sparks. What are sparks? Metal particles. And these sparks will ignite the gas. Okay? Then get a poop. The poops is okay, a little bit. But what this poops does is that the kicks up all the coal particle on the floor, on the ceiling, and all this. And then they will start burning. And the flame will start propagating out, and then they'll kick up the coal dust particle everywhere, started turbulent burning, and then very quickly, it's an enclosed space. They propagate, they become turbulent, then eventually detonate, bang, explosion. All right? So that's what those mine galleries is. Explosions of fuel tanks. Explosion of fuel tanks in the, again, we're talking fighting, right? So you have a bullet, whatever, you hit a fuel tank, you fill a fuel tank, and then the bullet will go through it, and then the fuel will come out. But anyway, your bullet will go through, and then it'll open up a hole in your fuel tank. And your fuel tank, that hole would generate metal particles, sparks, okay? And it's those sparks that could ignite your fuel. You know, in a fighter plane, whatever, you feel a hole is a hole, what's a big deal, right? So there's fuel leaking out. But the problem is that those things would explode. It's the explosion that hurts your thing. So you want to design your fuel tank pliable. When you have bullet coming in, it just opens up, pedals up without particles. Try to do that. Additives in solids and liquid propellants. I think I mentioned that before. You put carbon particle in solid, then they will give you additional heat content. All right, with this, and then of course synthesis of materials. That's what I said. That's you look at the table of elements, you can really synthesize a lot. You can synthesize very all sorts of materials, you know, electronic materials, very novel materials, very hard materials, electronic and all sorts of things. You know, Russians have been doing this for 30, 40 years to do that. So now, what are the fundamental peculiarities and interests? The products are usually in condensed phase when you burn metals, okay? Because, for example, hydrocarbon burning is just H2 and CO2. The gas phase, they go away, all right? But you have condensed phase. Now, those condensed products, they do not diffuse, so somehow they stay around there. They do not disperse the condensed phase, all right? So this is another thing I don't want to confuse you of. So in particular, also, the products can condense at the particle surface. So when you burn, just then I told you for alcohol droplet burn, the product's water, which will go to the surface and dissolve into the liquid, right? But for metal particle, the oxides will go to the surface. They won't dissolve. They will just sit at the surface. And then very quickly, they form a shell. They coat the whole particle. And then it stop burning, okay? So that's one big problem with particle burning. For example, with boron. Boron is a very good metal in terms of heat content and in terms of weight, boron. But it's got the hardest time to burn nicely because of boron oxide is very non-volatile. You just coat the boron particle and just stop burning, okay? You're dealing with different, you know, different kind of materials, something. Another thing I want to remember is N2 also can also be a reactant. N2 is a big participant. You know, you form nitrites and all this kind of thing. All right? So that's what we have, metal particle burn. Okay, let me talk about spray. How much time I have? 15 minutes? Huh? 10? Somebody wants to go home. It's okay, I just talk casually or something. It's spray burning, let me not talk about spray. Let me talk about today's special, daily specials, okay? Daily specials, synergistic burning of petroleum biofuels. Let me talk about droplet impact, that's something I'm interested in. Dynamics of droplet impact, that's kind of fun. You know, in the spray interior, of course, the droplets are everywhere, and then they may hit each other, right? So the question is, when they hit each other, what happens? And also I told you about raindrop formation. Raindrop comes down, they will hit each other, and then just grows. So for the longest time, people, when they look into droplet burning, collision, here you have two droplets. Very tiny, 100 micron, very tiny drop. They hit each other, then they merge, all right? So for the longest time, that's what people believe it is. They did experiments, but all with water experiments. So they'll come and merge, things like that. And long time ago, probably 30 years ago, my colleague at Princeton, Professor Bracco, he did engine research. If you guys look in, he's one of the pioneers for modern engine research. And he did some simulations of spray, and then he allowed for droplet, you know, collision, and then assumed they merge. You see, if they merge, then you have a small droplet become a big droplet, okay? So the gasification rate is all messed up. Your whole number density changes, all that stuff. So he did calculations. There's no way they can all merge. Whenever they hit each other, they merge, okay? It's just the numbers just turn out all right. Anyway, that got me to be interested in this. So then we did some experiments, not with the water, but also with hydrocarbon. But then you see that if you increase the impact inertia, go this way. So if it's small impact inertia, it'll merge. And if you increase the impact inertia, it won't merge, it bounce. Look at that, it'll bounce. And if you increase it again, it'll merge again. It's non-monotonic, okay? Merge, bounce, merge again. And then if you again increase the impact inertia, it'll merge and then it'll separate. And then when it separates, it produces a baby droplet impact. Okay, second generation. And certain time, this guy will further produce a third generation. It's beautiful fluid mechanics problem. I'm talking about fluid mechanics. Okay, forget about combustion, fluid mechanics. So this is very, very interesting. And anyway, so we published this paper. You know which group of people are really interested in my work in addition to spray and water? The physicists, the nuclear physicists. Because in nuclear physics, there's this water droplet model for nuclear fusions. They have two nuclear atoms here, they will whatever react and they have a nuclear reaction, right? They have a water droplet model. So they really like this kind of things. Anyway. If they're off-center, you see, if they're off-center, you go with those kind of things. And then you see that here's what I say, first generation and then second generation, they keep on just producing things. So the problem is, it's very rich, the problem, okay, for droplet collision. It's you have two droplets hitting each other. So when they hit, they deform, and so there's internal motion inside. So then you have viscous loss. So it's not elastic collision, it's inelastic collision. And then they have the interface here. There's air film between them. They have to break the air film in order for the surface to make contact, right? Otherwise they won't merge. It's very hard to break this air film because you need to squeeze the air film out from this interface. And this pressure buildup, they just won't go out, all right? So this region can go to very, very thin. It can go to the rarefied gas flow, okay? Rarefied gas flow, you have 100 nanometers, things like that. And eventually you have to break it very thin and then eventually you go to van der Waals force so that they will merge, all right? So this, I mentioned this, this is a beautiful fluid mechanics problem. Those of you who like CFD, you like this because there's many, many scales. Nobody has solved this problem from basics. To go all the way, all the length scale, from continuing with viscous loss to rarefied flow to the intermolecular attraction force. Like this, all right? But those are realistic problems. Now, let me also show you. I want to show nice pictures. It's fun compared with all the theories. So when two droplets merge, you see what happens? This is one droplet merging the other droplet. They go to here, you know, then they oscillate a little bit. This small droplet, right, oscillate a little bit, and then goes a little bit. It forms a jet, comes in, okay? It'll go oscillate, and then it decides to go, goes into a jet. It's beautiful, it's beautiful. Look at this, it's beautiful, it's a jet. But if you increase the inertia, then there's no jet, okay? You figure if you increase the inertia, it will have a jet, right? But it doesn't have a jet. The reason is simple, because when you increase the inertia, then there's too much deformation. Too much deformation, then viscous loss absorbs the inertia, then it doesn't go. Now, if you increase it further, you get a jet again, okay? So there's a difference between this jet and that jet, because this jet, what we call it's one-leg jet coming here, this is two-leg jet on both sides. Because it forms, the merging occurs at the rim on the side. Let's go this way. So the interest here actually is, again, propellants. hypergolic propellants. Hypergolic propellants. What you guys know what I mean? Hypergolic propellants. Again, tactical situations. Jet fuel, a lot of jet fuel, the rocket fuel, they're toxic. Rocket fuel, they're very toxic. So when people pump it in and whatever, this, you don't want to breathe it, it's very bad. So now you want to have a green propellant, right? Green propellant, so you put a lot of gelling agents in it to reduce the vapor pressure and all that. Huh? Gelling agents, vapor. But when you put all this guys in, then they don't vaporize. The droplets you come in, they don't vaporize, so they cannot react. So the thinking is that you make them to react in the liquid phase. You impinge droplets against each other. They mix, okay, in the liquid. Then in the liquid phase, they react. So that's why it's so important to know, to make them merge. First merge, and then make them to mix inside. So you need to understand how they mix, how fast they mix. But this is a beautiful problem. It's a fluid mechanics problem. You look at it, it's really fluid mechanics. All right? For that. Okay, let's see what else I have. Now, this droplet film impact, you know, you do inkjet printing and others. So you can have droplets coming here. Here's a film here. Sometimes they, you know, they won't merge. Printing, yes.
Can you go to the previous slide?
Previous slide.
On the type 2 jet.
Uh-huh.
Is that comparable to a gas bubble that is hit by a discontinuity where you get the Richtmeier-Wischkopf instability?
Yes, say that again.
When you have a gas bubble,
gas bubble
hit by a discontinuity, like a shock.
A shock?
You also get the
There are such possibilities. I have to think some more. It's a lot of it's surface tension. Okay. So bubble, yeah. What's giving the inertia of this jet is the surface tension. Because when they merge, the surface tension is gone, right? Where does it go to? It becomes the inertia, the surface tension. So anyway, the hitting of the surface that's, you know, in inkjet printing, you sometimes you want to mix different colors. You want to mix different colors. So you have jets, you have one jet give you one color, another jet comes another color, another droplet, so they mix to that, okay? So maybe the first one have some kind of film, first one lands here, second one goes there. So there's a lot of interest in this. To do that. And then those are droplets, and this is a jet, a real jet. This is actually fairly new results. So you see droplet got those four types, right? So it turns out the jet also has four types. If it's low inertia, then they will merge two jets. Higher inertia, they bounce away, and then merge again. And then they merge, then they separate. Mm-hmm. So this, again, it's just nice, very nice fluid mechanics problem with this. So I think that's it. So I probably should let you guys go. Huh? I can talk another 3 hours. I'm sorry, I can't finish everything, but you get the notes. Yeah.